Okay, what I want to talk to you about is one of the probably the most exciting thing that's happened in physics in this century, short as it is. The detection of gravity waves. 100 years ago, Einstein developed a theory of general relativity, a very unusual theory in which gravity is not a force, as Newton had phrased it, but gravity is, in the simplest case, near the surface of the Earth, is the inequitable flow of time from one place to the next. That time does not flow the same way everywhere in the universe. It flows differently at the surface of the Earth than away from it, and that's what gravity is. I could give a whole lecture on this. I have done so. But that's not today's lecture. In 1916, Einstein was looking at some of the consequences of this theory he had developed. And he pointed out that, at least in some approximation, it seemed that this theory had waves, gravitational waves, embedded in it. He introduced the concept. He made some mistakes. Einstein was a famous one for making mistakes and not really caring, because the next day he would go ahead and fix them. Well, this one took a little longer than the next day. He published another paper in 1918 where he fixed, in particular, how the sources had to act in order to produce gravitational radiation. He introduced the so-called quadrupole formula, something that we still use today, and many of the techniques in this paper we still use today. He also basically said that these were things that would absolutely never be detected because they were just so small. What are gravitational waves? Well, as I said, the gravity near the surface of the Earth is the inequitable flow of time from place to place. One of the features of Einstein's relativity theory was that space and time were really similar. So in addition to getting an inequitable flow of time from place to place, you could have an inequitable distance from time to time. In other words, distance could simply change on their own. One usually thinks about distance as something, you know, the distance from me to you, that changes because I move. Well, in this theory, the distance from me to you can simply change on its own. I'm standing here, I'm not moving. He's sitting there, he's not moving. He knows he's not moving because he doesn't feel any forces. He doesn't feel any accelerations. And suddenly, he discovers that he's farther away from me than he was before. This is something that can happen in general relativity. I.e., if I've got two observers sitting there, they can suddenly discover that the number of rulers they can fit between themselves can increase or decrease. One of the places where this occurs is the so-called expansion of the universe, which many people think of as if it were a big explosion, and all the pieces got thrown out and they're getting farther and farther apart because, you know, they're moving. That's actually wrong. They're just sitting there. They're sitting at rest, and the reason they're getting farther apart is that the universe is creating more room for itself to live in. If only we could do that to our houses and add a little bit of extra space in the house just by increasing the distances in the house. Well, the universe can do that. These changes in distance, which can travel, occur perpendicular to the direction in which this gravitational wave is traveling. So if it's traveling that way, the distances in these directions change. And they change in a compensatory manner in such a way that the areas don't change. So if the distances in this direction suddenly get larger, the distances in this direction have to get smaller, and vice versa. So these waves travel along as these changes in distances travel along at the velocity of light. Now I've got a little video, which I hope works, of this. What you're going to see is the Livingston detector, the Livingston gravitational wave detector that's near Baton Rouge, Louisiana, in the swamps out there. And we're going to see the effect of a gravity wave traveling by there. Now, in order that we can see it, what we're going to be looking at is a gravity wave that's much, 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 much larger. A one followed by about 20 zeros times larger than the actual wave that they actually did see. So this would be the effect of a gravity wave traveling through Livingston. You notice that that point up at the top, which is the center, which is the intersection point, is stationary. So what that gravity wave was how it would look for somebody sitting there. It looks as though somebody sitting down at this end would feel himself being whopped back and forth, right, as this gravity wave went by. No, he would simply see exactly the same thing, but with himself being at rest and with everything else moving around instead. Both of the people would think that they're just sitting at rest and everybody else is moving. That sounds about right. Where do these gravity waves originate? They originate from motions of masses. So for example, if one had a dumbbell, you know, these weights that you lift, and you spin it very rapidly, then that produces these waves that travel out. They're longer in this direction than they are in this direction. As that dumbbell rotates, you get these the wave also rotates. These were the first calculations that Einstein did. One of the big questions was, if you had two stars orbiting each other, in other words, they're not tied together by a rod, but they're tied together gravitationally, would that emit gravitational radiation? And this was an argument that went on for 50 years as to whether or not that kind of a system would produce gravity waves or not. Many people, in fact, one of the arguments that kept going on for 50 years was whether or not even gravity waves existed at all, or whether they were just sort of a figment of the theorist's imagination called coordinate changes. One of the problems in general relativity is there's no definite way of saying where something is, so maybe you're just being mistaken in where you think it is and you think it's wiggling around when it's just sitting there. It was only in the 1950s and the 1960s that people really became convinced that these things existed and could actually do stuff. Now, one of the things that happened, and I'm not going to cover that, but is there were evidence that gravity waves actually did exist when people looked at some of these so-called binary pulsars, where you had two neutron stars orbiting each other. They should emit gravity waves very, very weakly. And what Hulse and Taylor first discovered was that two of these neutron stars orbiting each other gradually lost energy. And they would whip around each other faster and faster as they lost energy. It was tiny, tiny fractions of loss of energy. Over 20 years, the amount of change in energy of this thing was something like 10 to the minus 10, one followed by 10 zeros, one over that, of the energy of the system. It was a very, very gradual change, but because pulsars are such incredibly good clocks, one could actually see that change in energy. And this agreed more or less exactly with what Einstein predicted. The problem is that those events were really weak gravity. If one even went right to the system that was doing the gravitational radiation, you found that the changes in lengths were only about one part in 10 billion. Really, really tiny changes. So one of the questions is, can one get situations in which these changes in length produced by the gravity waves were much bigger? 1%, 5%, 10%, something like that. That's what you would need in order to really be able to detect them on the Earth. How does one detect them? Well, these things change distances. So you just measure the change in distance. When you put in the numbers, you find that the changes in distances are just so small that it becomes really hard to detect them. And there's basically two ways of doing them. The first way that was tried by Joe Weber was when the distances, for example, in a big lump of aluminum, which is what he used, the distances between the atoms change a little bit. The aluminum says, wait, I don't want that atom to be that far away from me. Come back here. And it responds by placing pulls and pushes on itself. Of course, the gravity wave goes by. It's now started the other guy moving, and the gravity wave is left ringing, and you might be able to hope to see that ringing. The second way is to directly measure that change in distance from one place to the next. So it was in basically in the 1980s, starting actually earlier than that in the 1960s, that Ray Weiss at MIT, Kip Thorne at Caltech, and they hired away from Edinburgh, Ron Drever, to start up a little laser interferometer system at Caltech. The way in which this is supposed to work is that you're trying to send out light and you want to time how long does it take light to get from here out to a distant mirror and bounce back to you. Obviously, that time tells you how far away that mirror is. And so if that mirror is suddenly farther away, it's going to take longer for the light to go out and to bounce back. The problem is there ain't any clocks that are accurate enough to do that. So how do you do that? Well, you have the light beam, the laser beam, sort of time itself. In other words, instead of having simply one arm that you're trying to measure the distance to, you have two of them. And you want to measure the difference in time between those two guys. Well, light, as we know, is a wave. It has crests and troughs. So you send out these waves towards these two mirrors. And then you come back and you ask, okay, are these crests and troughs still lined up? They were completely lined up when you left. And if they're not exactly lined up when they come back, you might be able to detect that. The difference in lining up turns out to be about one part in a million billion. So this is very small. And basically what you do is you take one of those crests and troughs, flip it over, add it to the other one, and see whether the two exactly cancel or not. And if they don't exactly cancel, you know that something has happened. This all sounds very simple. The problem is that there are all kinds of problems. One of the key ones is ground jiggling. One of these is built in Hanford in Washington. Washington State is not the seismically quietest place in the world. The other one they decided to build in Louisiana. They went there, they measured the seismicity. They decided to try and see that it was a very quiet site. They built their instrument They just were getting ready to start operating when the lumber trucks drove in. All of the land around wasn't owned by them. It was owned by a lumber company who decided this was a good time to start harvesting the trees. That's one problem. Even trucks driving by on the highway wiggle. Windstorms blowing over the enclosure have turbulent eddies which cause things to shake. Never mind, the wind going over, when it produces these eddies, it has a low pressure area in the middle, so there's less air in the middle, and just the Newtonian force of that less amount of air that's blowing over your detector is enough to jiggle the end mirrors enough to be able to be detected if you didn't work really hard at it. It's such that at Hanford, even the waves breaking in the ocean 300 kilometers away jiggles the ground enough. So somehow you have to isolate those mirrors incredibly accurately to prevent all of this ground shaking from destroying your ability to measure. And in fact, at some frequencies, at the low frequencies, that's still the dominant source of noise. There's measurement noise. Light acts like photons, and I'm going to talk about this more later on. And so these particles of light come out one at a time, and they come out randomly. That randomness looks like noise. Is that a gravity wave signal, or is that just the randomness of the light coming out? You could try and increase the power, but in the laser system, which might make this a little bit less, but as soon as you increase the power, the problem is you start heating those mirrors. As we'll see, they already have 100 kilowatts of power bouncing between those two mirrors. 100 kilowatts is the amount of electricity that something like 300 or 400 houses use up. And that's all bouncing between those two mirrors and threatening to heat up the mirrors. One has to design these mirrors with incredible accuracy so that they reflect 99.9999999% of the light and don't absorb any of it and heat up. You've got to evacuate a tube. In this case, 4 kilometer long tube, about this big in diameter, and bring it down to one of the very best vacuums, because those air molecules can scatter the light. And that scattered light produces noise which can mimic gravity waves. So this is what the detector basically looks like. You have these mirrors. Is there a pointer somewhere? You have these, there we go. You have these mirrors here. The distance from here to here is 4 kilometers. Yeah, I don't know. So you have a 20 watt laser that shines into the system. It bounces between these mirrors here and gets amplified. And finally, when it gets into this, between these two mirrors, bouncing back and forth, it gets amplified up to about 100 kilowatts. In order to produce the seismic isolation, to stop these mirrors from moving whenever the ground shakes, you hang them on these sort of pendula. In other words, you have Which one? That one? Might work. Okay. You hang these mirrors from pendula, in fact, four different stages. You have a big, huge steel mass up here, another one down here, then another big fused silica mass down here, and finally the mirrors hanging down here. These mirrors are approximately 40 kilograms in weight, and they're about this big around. When something shakes at the top, as you know, if you've got a pendulum there, you shake the top faster than the whole thing usually oscillates, the bottom one doesn't move at all. And that's what you're relying on. Only you have to have at least all of these four stages, and you have to make very special mounts for them, these fused silica fibers, so that you don't get little earthquakes happening in the fibers. For example, if you use just ordinary steel and you hang these 40 kilograms from the steel, there are these little grains in the steel that start jerking at themselves and producing little earthquakes, if you will, or string quakes, which would jiggle the mirrors. They so far haven't gone ahead and cooled these down, although the Japanese are building devices where they want to cool all of this whole mirror system down to about a tenth of a degree above absolute zero as well, to stop any thermal motion jiggling these mirrors. There are two sites in the United States. One is at Hanford in the desert, very close to the nuclear reactors from the Second World War, where the plutonium was generated. The other one, as I mentioned, was in the swamps of Louisiana. These two guys, although they don't look like it, if you look down upon the Earth from a point directly above the point midway between them, they look they're basically identical detectors. They're oriented exactly the same way as each other. They're about 10 light seconds apart. In other words, if you had a beam of light, 10 light milliseconds apart, if you had a beam of light that you shone from Hanford, which could travel through the Earth to Livingston, it would take approximately 10 milliseconds, a hundredth of a second, to get from one to the other one. That's about 3,000 kilometers separating them. The tubes, as it says here, has about a billionth of an atmosphere. All of those tubes are surrounded by thick concrete sort of building. You wonder, why would they need that concrete building? The problem is that people in both places drive around and take pot shots at it. So they have to make sure that they've got enough concrete that those pot shots don't get through and destroy their vacuum for them. That was one of the big expenses of building these things, was to protect them from these idiot hunters. There are others as well. There's a small one in Germany. None of these are operating right now in near Hanover. There's Virgo, which is about 3 kilometer long interferometer near Pisa. There's one in Kagra in West Japan that's down in a mine, and that one they want to cool down to a few tenths of a degree above absolute zero. It's a slightly smaller one. Both Virgo and that one are slightly smaller. About 2 days after the announcement that they had detected gravitational radiation, India agreed to accept a gift from the United States, which was, when they originally built at Hanford, they actually built two laser interferometers, one sitting right beside the other, more or less sharing the space. One was only 2 kilometers long and the other one was 4. It was primarily for design, you know, as a place to test things out. So they offered to India that they would transport everything over to them, give it to them, as long as India set up and operated the system. 2 days after the announcement, India said, "Oh, okay, yeah, we'll take your gift," which is great. They're all going to take a while to come online. India is probably going to be about 10 years. Anyway, they set this whole system up, and they searched for 10 years. This was about 2002. On and off, they would have these various science runs, and they saw nothing. NSF had put in about $500 million. Everybody was wondering whether NSF's pockets would suddenly start to dry up, but they didn't. They said, okay, we're going to improve, and about 9 months ago, they had produced an advanced version. They put in heavier mirrors, better seismic isolation. They increased the laser power, better mirror coatings so that the mirrors wouldn't heat up, etc., to produce something that was somewhere between 3 to 10 times more sensitive than the old one was. Now, there's an important feature in the search. If you're looking for something and you don't know what you're looking for, it helps to know what you're looking for. But what kind of things are you going to look for? One of the things that happened over the last 10 years was suddenly numerical relativity, a field that had been started in the 1970s by basically Bryce DeWitt at the University of Texas, persuaded one of his students, Larry Smarr, to start trying to solve Einstein's equations on the computer. Hopelessly naive, he tried, didn't get very far. Over the next 30 years, more and more groups got involved because LIGO was being built. One wanted to know what was going on. They could never get, for example, 2 black holes to orbit each other even once. The code would keep crashing. It was only in about 2005 that Franz Pretorius a student of Matt Choptowick, who's a professor at the University of British Columbia, who developed a lot of the techniques and trained incredibly, you know, was an incredibly good trainer of students. One of his students, Franz Pretorius, suddenly on his own, not working with any group, produced the 4-stable evolution where 2 black holes would orbit each other for 10 or 20 times before they crashed into each other. That broke the logjam. Suddenly everybody was able to do it. And over the next 10 years, they built up this incredible bank of solutions to Einstein's equations for 2 black holes orbiting each other. Black holes because they're the simplest objects. Neutron stars could also orbit each other. The trouble is neutron stars are made out of matter. And matter has got all kinds of difficulties with it. It does things. It explodes, it deforms under tides, etc. So that's a much, much more difficult problem. And they finally built up this huge bank, the so-called template bank, of various sizes of black holes orbiting each other, you know, one bigger than the other, or almost the same size, etc. One of the things that you discover is, I mean, one of the things you don't have to worry about is how far away they are, because it turns out that the amplitudes of the waves simply drop off as 1 over the distance, which is good, because that means you don't have to build up template banks, which is, you know, this one is this far away, this is this far away, etc. You can just do one, usually about 50 templates for some mass ratio that you're going to try and look for in the data. One of the things you discover is that the rate at which these waves jiggle up and down depends directly on the mass of the system. And in particular, these final wiggles, how fast these are going, gives you directly how massive the final thing is that gets produced when these two black holes collide. So one can directly read off of the signal how big the system is. And by looking at the details of the previous cycles, one can also determine how big each one of the individual masses was. So this is a signal. This is, in fact, the signal which is the best fit to the detection that took place. One of the things that, if you can see, read the labels down here, which are small enough that even I can't read them, this whole time period is less than a hundredth of a second. And, you know, this final merger takes place in just over a thousandth of a second. Now things, so this oscillation period down here is about 250 times a second, which is audible. So one should be able to listen to this. So let me see if I can get this going. So here's what that gravity wave signal sounds like. Do you hear it? Well, let me try it again. Hear that little thump? I don't know if I can, but let me try. Yeah. That was it. Yeah. That's what all the excitement was about. That little thump. Let me get back here. Yes. Anyway, in September 14th, about 3 o'clock in the morning at Livingston, this is what came out of the detector. There's nothing there but noise. All you can see here is noise. That scale along the side tells you how big the noise is. And up in the top, it tells you that this is about 10 to the minus 18. One followed by 18 zeros and one divided by that. Terribly small. All of that is noise. Most of it is things like seismic noise. There's all kinds of other noise in there. But if you filter out the low frequencies below about 30 hertz, which is what they did, and you filter out frequencies above about 500 hertz, suddenly what you see is this. There's a huge signal there. You don't have to play any special games in order to see that signal. You can see the thing wiggling up and down just as you expect it, getting bigger and suddenly merging and dying away. The two signals at Livingston and at Hanford were separated by about 7 milliseconds. That indicates that the signal was coming in at about 45 degrees to the line joining the two detectors. I.e., it hit Livingston first, and then the signal came down and hit Washington about 7 milliseconds later. The two signals are almost the same amplitude, which gives us a feeling as to which direction more directly it gets. You know, the 45 degrees just gives you a big circle on the sky. This narrows it down to about 30 degrees on the sky of that circle. The timing tells us what the total mass is. It's about 60 times the mass of the sun. So the final black hole that was formed here was about 60 times the solar mass. Each of them was about half of that. One was about 28 and the other was about 36. If you measure the amplitude of that wave, remember that wave had an amplitude of about 10 to the minus 21. 1 divided by 1 followed by 21 zeros. Incredibly weak amplitude. That's how much the distance has changed, the arms of LIGO. That's much less than 1/100th of a proton radius. And that's what they were able to measure. That tells us that this system was about 1 billion light years away. The amount of energy was such that while that gravity wave was emitted, it was producing more energy during that time period than all of the light energy of all of the stars in the visible universe. That one source was, in gravity waves, brighter than the whole rest of the universe combined. Of course, gravity waves interact so weakly that you couldn't see it. One of the questions, this shows where the best estimate is of where it came from. This is basically the southern sky. There's the South Pole, Earth's South Pole points in that direction. There's a small Magellanic Cloud just at the tip of that arrow. And the area from which the pulse probably came from just about exactly covers the Large Magellanic Cloud. There it is. The Large Magellanic Cloud sits right there. The Large Magellanic Cloud, however, is only a few thousand light years away from us, not a billion light years away from us. So it certainly didn't come from the Large Magellanic Cloud. As if that wasn't enough, 3 months later, in December, in fact, in the United States, it was still Christmas Day, they got a Christmas present, which was another detection. This one was much smaller. You notice the noise up there, and you notice as part of that, that there seems to be this signal in there. There seems to be the signal in there. Well, that's been drawn in because that's the best fit signal to what was dug out of the noise there. And if you integrate that signal against the noise, you find this very, very strong peak, which at Hanford and at Livingston, which tells you that that gravity wave, that particular template, matches extremely well to some sort of signal buried down in the noise. This one, which was announced last week, was about 8 solar mass for one of them and about 14 solar mass for the other one, producing a combination of about 20 solar masses or 21 solar masses, which meant that one solar mass got radiated away as gravitational radiation from this system. This one, the best estimate is that it's about 1.4 billion light years away. So one has two very strong signals in 3 months. These things happen, seem to be happening all the time, and we only now have the sensitivity to start seeing that. The best estimate of, because it's weaker, it's much harder to tell where it came from, the best estimate of where in the sky it was, in this case, the difference in time between Hanford and Livingston was about 1 millisecond instead of 7, so that indicates that it was almost directly on a circle perpendicular to the line joining Hanford to Livingston. Much less accurately set on the sky. So these are exciting times. But what I, since we're at the Institute for Quantum something or other, the quantum is the important thing. One of the amazing things is that this system is one of the most, one of the biggest quantum systems in the world. Why do I say that? In 1925, Heisenberg, developing the theory of quantum mechanics, came up with this little idea of what he called his microscope, or what was called afterwards, the Heisenberg microscope. It was his Gedanken experiment to try and understand a result he had derived, namely that one couldn't determine the position and the momentum, momentum being mass times the velocity, of a particle with arbitrary accuracy at the same time. And what he thought of was setting up a little, this was a Gedanken experiment, in which one had a particle which he thought of as an electron or something like that, and you shine a light wave on that particle. Now some of the light gets scattered, and you want to collect that scattered light with a mirror, a lens to try and figure out where the particle is. Well, it turns out that the best thing that you can do to determine where the particle is something like with an uncertainty, which is the wavelength, the distance between the peaks of these waves, divided by the angle, which is the angle that the lens gives you as seen from the particle. That's the best that you can determine where the position of that particle is. But since light is also particles, when the light gets scattered by this particle, it bounces off it and pushes it around. And if you ask how accurately, how much push does it give, it gives an uncertainty to the momentum, which goes as Planck's constant, an incredibly tiny number, 10 to the minus 34, some such order, divided by the wavelength times the angle. Well, when you multiply this by this, the lambdas cancel out, the thetas cancel out, and all you're left with is with h bar. Namely, that there's always this uncertainty. If you measure the distance very accurately, the momentum becomes very uncertain. If you measure the momentum very accurately, the distance becomes very uncertain. This is the famous Heisenberg uncertainty principle. That also works for this LIGO laser interferometer, because what you're doing is you're using light to try and figure out where those mirrors are and try to see over the course of time how much those mirrors move. If you try to measure their position too accurately, you're going to be pushing on those mirrors, and the next time you measure their position is going to be very uncertain because of that push on the mirrors. If you want to decrease the pushing on the mirrors, then you can't measure it as accurately. Remember, those are 40 kilogram mirrors. And you'd say, what in the world does quantum mechanics have to do with something this big? The quantum mechanics gives us a limit as to how accurately we can measure it. So here we have that interferometer again. We have a 20-watt laser source coming in here, 100 watts bouncing back in, 100 kilowatts bouncing back and forth in here. And if everything is lined up perfectly, virtually no light comes out of this port. If one of the ends moves a tiny bit with respect to the other one, more light comes up, more or less light comes out of this port over here, and one can see that those mirrors have moved. Now, not only is light coming in to this port, there's also something coming into this other port. You say, what something? They designed this thing so that nothing comes in there. They make everything as dark as possible. The only thing coming in here is vacuum. In other words, no light. But quantum mechanics tells us that even if you have a situation in which there's the least amount of light possible, there's always some fluctuation in the electric and the magnetic fields. Just like Heisenberg's uncertainty principle for particles, there's an uncertainty principle for these light fluctuations getting into the interferometer. And what you find is that there are two sorts of problems which this causes. This is a diagram of, it's basically the hoped-for situation with the next upgrading of LIGO. But the important thing here is that the black curve is the noise that you expect to get from the interferometer as a function of the frequency that of the radiation of the gravity waves that you're looking for. At this part of the curve, you notice that all of the noise is basically what's called shot noise. This is fluctuations in amplitude coming out of the system. At this point, most of the noise, until you get down to the place where the seismic noise takes over, down around 20 to 30 hertz, is what's called radiation pressure noise, namely that the light inside the interferometer is a little stronger in this interferometer arm than this one, and that pushes on the mirror and can mimic a gravity wave. But both of those are quantum. They're coming about precisely because of those vacuum fluctuations that are coming into that unused port. Let me give a little diagram for this. Here's my interferometer, and there's two kinds of fluctuations that can come in. So here's the laser, and I've exaggerated everything by a factor of, again, about 10 to the 20, one followed by 20 zeros times what actually is the case, because otherwise you wouldn't be able to see it. So here's the laser going in, and here's a little vacuum fluctuation coming in. Half of it goes up here, half of it goes down this way. Notice that this laser fluctuation is lined up perfectly with the oscillations of the main beam, i.e. when there's a peak there, there's a peak here, and when you add these together, you get a slightly higher peak. The red one is the laser, and the black one is the sum of the laser plus this vacuum fluctuation. So this guy is a little bit stronger. In this case, the peak lines up with a valley. And so the black is a little bit weaker than the red one. So in this arm, that radiation is going to be pushing on that end mirror slightly less than it is in this one. And that, of course, causes that end mirror to move a tiny little distance. And that looks like a gravity wave. Well, there's another kind of fluctuation that can come in. This is a fluctuation in which the shift of the peaks and the valleys here with respect to that is about a quarter of a wavelength. When you add these two guys together, what it does is it makes this wave seem as though it's traveling a little bit later than this one. This one gets retarded a little bit. This one gets advanced a little bit. They go off to the mirrors. They come back. This one is still a bit retarded. This one's a bit advanced. This is a bit advanced. This is a bit retarded. They combine here, and it looks as though those two arm lengths are different. So you suddenly get more light coming out in this direction, and it looks like a gravity wave has come by. Those are the two kinds of noise. This is what's called shot noise. This is called radiation pressure noise. And they obey an uncertainty relationship, which is exactly the same as the Heisenberg one, and would seem to limit our ability to actually detect the gravitational radiation. It turns out it's not true. One can get around it. And the way, basically, the idea is that you don't care where those mirrors are. What you care is to measure the changes produced by the gravity wave. And by keeping that important principle in mind, one can actually have ways of getting around the situation. And it's something that's called squeezing. One squeezes the vacuum in such a way that one can actually reduce one of those sources of noise at the expense of making the other one bigger. But if we go back to that diagram, we notice that in this range of frequencies, shot noise dominates. So if you squeeze the vacuum in such a way as to decrease that shot noise fluctuation, you can decrease the noise here. If at the same time you squeeze it in such a way that in this set of frequencies you decrease the radiation pressure noise, you can decrease this down here as well. And it turns out that even in this regime where the shot noise and the radiation pressure are almost the same intensity, by squeezing it in just the right way, you can actually decrease this noise here. So by doing this squeezing, you can actually decrease the noise due to this quantum system all the way across the bands. They aren't doing that yet. It's really hard. The squeeze thing is, in fact, weird. You think, wait, you've got nothing coming in. You know, what's less than nothing? Well, it turns out that something is less than nothing in this case, because once you squeeze this vacuum, it turns out that it looks as though there's actually light going into the interferometer in those directions. It's highly fluctuating type of light. It's such that there are always two photons that go in at the same time, which is what the squeezing is all about. But by adding just the right kind of light to this interferometer, one can in fact reduce this quantum noise all the way across the system. One can't reduce these other noises. This one, which is the really bad one, is the seismic one, and the only way one can reduce that is going off into space, which is of course one of the proposals to build an interferometer out in space called LISA. But they're planning on implementing this in the next round over the next 5 years or so in both LIGO and in Virgo, i.e. by the time the India detector will come online. And that should increase the sensitivity by about another factor of 3 over even what's indicated there. So every factor of 3 in sensitivity increases the volume of space that you can search by about a factor of 27, i.e. 3 times 3 times 3. So one would expect, instead of seeing one every 2 months, we will start seeing one every week or every few days. and one can really start to do physics. Now, one of the features about the signal that was detected was, did anything else happen? One of the problems with black holes is those black holes have been running around, vacuuming up the space around them, so there's almost nothing else left. And when they collide, there's nothing else to, you know, glow or emit radiation. Immediately they saw this, they phoned up all of their friends. For example, the ice cube experiment at the South Pole, where they're looking for neutrinos, saying, did you see any, yeah, this is real top secret, you know, don't tell anybody, but did you see any neutrinos down around September or whatever it was? And they phoned up the gamma ray observatories. Well, one of them said, well, we saw some sort of pulse. Unfortunately, the direction towards the source of the gravity wave was right along the edge of the Earth. And I think nobody now believes that they saw anything. It would be very surprising because the black holes should have vacuumed up all of space so that you shouldn't see anything. You know, and they looked for the optical and so forth. Nothing else was seen coming from that direction of the sky. If they eventually see, for example, two neutron stars colliding with each other, there you might well expect to see humongous bursts of gamma rays and X-rays being given off. But so far they haven't seen that. All they've seen are these wonderful pristine systems where two black holes are orbiting each other and eventually crashing into each other. Anyway, you know, we've seen now gravitational radiation directly on the Earth. The strength of the sources was at least 10%. So the amount of shrinkage and expansion was at least 10% if you were very, very close to those black holes as they were orbiting each other due to the gravity waves. They were incredibly strong gravity waves at the source, incredibly weak once they got to us. Furthermore, we've shown that quantum mechanics applies to even these objects, you know, 40 kilograms and this big. Quantum mechanics is not just something that has to do with these tiny little electrons and protons and so forth. It also applies to these big, humongous things. And Heisenberg's microscope really works. It wasn't just a thought idea. So both Einstein's ideas of gravitational radiation really work, and Heisenberg's microscope really work. That second one is much less exciting than the first one. Anyway, keep watching. These are going to be incredibly exciting times. We're going to be looking at the universe in a totally different way for the next 10, 20, and 30 years, and we've got no idea what we're going to find. That's one of the wonderful things. As we know, every time we develop instruments that see in some new way, look around us in some new way, all kinds of surprises pop up. And the first surprise was, where in the world did 30 solar mass black holes come from, and why in the world are they orbiting each other? Why are they so close to each other that in the last, you know, billion years, they've actually been able to radiate away all of their energy and collide into each other? They were each, this is 30 times the mass of the sun. The diameter is about the distance from here to Toronto of these black holes, and they're whipping around each other at about a fifth or a third the velocity of light. 120 times a second. Anyway, that's about all I have to say.